Morning Lake Michigan Christian Center. I'm so glad you could join us for our online service. I've got a great word for you this morning, but before we get to that, we've got an online meet and greet. Take a moment, reach out to some people, get as many people as possible watching these online services. All right, I'll see you on the other side of the meet and greet. Well, good morning, Lake Michigan Christian Center. I'm so glad you could join us for our online service. I'm continuing to talk about the most magnificent of all stories. And what frames what I started developing last week is a quote from a pastor that I follow on Twitter named Matt Smethurst. And basically he said this, and it really piqued my attention. It really captured me, my thinking, and provoked me a little bit. But he said this. He said, the greatest threat to Christmas is not secularism, is not consumerism, but our own boredom with the most magnificent story ever told. And that just really, really captured my attention, because for so many Christians, and maybe you're one of them, I know at times I've wrestled with this. I get so familiar with the Christmas story. I know the story, I know the beginning, I know the ending, I know what goes on with it, you know, and it's easy sometimes to kind of lose our attention or our focus because we think we know all about it, but there is so much more to the story. And again, there was so much backstory going on as Jesus was born that has parallels with our own generation. I mean, you've got the Jews who were expecting a Messiah, the Jews who were expecting a deliverer that were going to deliver the Jews from the political oppression from the Roman Empire. You had all of this expectation. You had the rise of all kinds of Jewish nationalism. We want the Jewish nation to be strong and flourish and thrive, and we want to push back the Romans, very similar to so much of the Christian nationalism that is reverberating through the body of Christ in America. And again, I am so for God doing a work in this country, but we cannot elevate America and our expectation of it above the kingdom of God. Jesus prayed, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He never said anything about a nation state being developed as a part of that prayer. And then you throw in paranoia of King Herod, who, you know, was like worried about another king or another usurper to his throne, going around slaughtering babies. And we know the scourge of abortion in America, 60 million babies and counting. No, there's a lot of very interesting parallels. And to me, we should be anything but bored with the Christmas story. So I want to finish up what I talked about, began to talk about last week. And I want you to look at John's Gospel, the first chapter and verse 5, and then verses 9 through 14. So the scripture says this, the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this Christmas story. I thank you for the incarnation. I thank you for its power. I thank you for its majesty. I thank you, Lord God, that it is the key to the salvation of the entire human race. God taking on manhood. So God, I pray as we look at this this idea of the most magnificent of all stories, God, I pray that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear what your Spirit has for us today, Father. And I thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, looking at John chapter 1 verse 10, it says, he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. And so what we need to understand is, again, the story of the incarnation is the most it's the most unrecognized of all visitations, right? Somebody visiting somebody else and then not recognizing. That's an incredible part of the Christmas story. And I read an account this past week about Elvis and Elvis's life that I thought was very, very interesting. And it was an account of his friend Lil from Lil Thompson's Steakhouse in Tennessee. And again, as his career was developing, he was becoming more and more famous. Lil would give him free steak dinners all the time. So Elvis, like probably I or you or I would do, hey, I'm going for a free steak dinner. Well, what Lil decided to do is to have an Elvis impersonation contest. And so this was done at the height of Elvis's career. And so Elvis shows up at this contest, and he's in the very back row, and he's watching the thing, and he looks over to a friend and says, you know, I think I'm going to mash this thing. I'm gonna go for it. I'm going to sing a song. So he ends up singing Love Me Tender to mild applause. It wasn't raging applause. It was just kind of mild applause. And people basically were kind of like, yeah, I guess the guy was okay. And he ends up getting third place in an Elvis impersonation contest. Talk about adventures and missing the point. Talk about missing a visitation. Elvis himself was in the building actually singing, and the crowd didn't even know it was him, right? That's an incredibly surprising, you know, mistake. But when we come to the incarnation, God taking on manhood and being born in a manger in Bethlehem, okay? The tragic mistake was that most did not even recognize him. They didn't even know it. And again, it's a powerful, powerful display of human ignorance, because of all people that should have recognized him, it should have been the Jews, the Jewish people who had messianic expectations that had gone on for hundreds and hundreds of years. Again, remember, the time between the Old Testament and the New Testament is called the silent years. There's about 400 of them. And so they were eagerly anticipating a word from God. They were eagerly anticipating a visitation from God. And then when God shows up, they didn't see it. They missed it. They didn't recognize him. And what John brings out is, he said, listen, the actual world itself was made by God. Was made by Jesus, rather. And they didn't even recognize it. Again, that is the height of... you know, I struggle to find the right words. That the one who actually created you, the one that actually created the world, the one that actually created, as it were, a God-shaped void within every single one of us, that we were designed by our Creator to have fellowship with him. When the Creator came, people didn't even recognize him. And it's interesting, I'm thinking of Colossians 1, 16 and 17, which says this, by him all things were created, things in heaven and on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones, powers, rulers, authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. So the scripture says very clearly that in Christ, the entire planet, the solar systems, the orbits, the oceans, the tides, the boundaries of all of these nations, it's all held together in Christ, and he shows up and people don't even see it, don't even notice it. And it's interesting, theologians will tell us that everything that's created in this world and in the whole universe actually has what they call a word shape or a logos shape. Remember, it says in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Jesus is the Word, and theologians will tell us that, listen, everything that's created has that shape to it, visible or invisible. It doesn't matter, that everything in all of creation is basically infused with a second person of the Trinity shape, a fitting form that matches the eternal form of the Word. And the theologians will go on to say that creation was created to be an analogy of the eternal Son in creaturely form. So in other words, everything finds its ultimate purpose, meaning, sense of being in the Son of God who created all things, who in him everything is consisting, and yet we missed it. Right? That's incredibly, incredibly tragic. So a tragic mistake is not recognizing Jesus. But the scripture says here in the Gospel of John that it's actually even worse than that. That when Jesus came, it wasn't, and again, John in this section of the gospel is summarizing humanity and humanity's reception of Jesus well beyond the incarnation. But again, it reveals the human propensity to not just not recognize Jesus, but when he is clearly conveyed, when it's clearly communicated who he is, and the gospel and its message of salvation, that so many people, you know, they want to stick their finger in their ears and go la 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 and not even, I don't want to receive him. And that's what it says in John 1 verse 11. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. And again, that's, you know, it's not just a tragic mistake, it's fatal in eternal consequences sort of way, right? for all of eternity, if you don't receive Jesus, if you don't receive what he's done for you at the cross, you will spend eternity separated from God. That is brutal, okay? And that is a fatal mistake. But humanity, in Jesus's time when he was born, during his life and ministry, and then ultimately the ultimate rejection and the crucifixion, they have not received him. And then generation after generation after generation of people, when presented with the gospel, many don't. Now, many do, but there's a large number of people that do not. And again, that the tragedy is that the very, if you will, vaccine that can inoculate the human race and heal them of sin and heal them of rebellion towards God and heal them from ultimate death, because again, the resurrection, we're all going to be resurrected, okay? Humanity's rejected that. And again, there's so much controversy as I'm recording this about vaccines and vaccine mandates and vaccine boosters and all that kind of stuff. And some people look at those that don't get the vaccine and go, what's wrong with you? You know, aren't you going to embrace this? You know, you're going to be doomed if you don't. In fact, our president has just recently made an announcement that those that are unvaccinated, you're going to face a winter of all kinds of, you know, calamity and darkness and doom. And it's like, okay. Let's put things in perspective. The fundamental problem for humanity is not physical sickness, but sin that is fatal if left untreated for all of eternity. And Jesus comes as a baby, and then of course grows up, lives, teaches, ministers under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, lays down his life for the whole world, and opens himself up to everyone and says, listen, if you just receive me, you're going to find life, okay? It's an incredible, fatal tragedy of epic proportions. I'm running out of superlatives for people to say, I don't want that. And that's what John's gospel is communicating. And that's what the incarnation and Christmas is communicating. Some will recognize him and reach out to him and receive, but others will reject him and refuse him. And again, it's a sobering consequence of living in a fallen world. And what is even more sobering is that if you don't receive Jesus, you're still going to receive another Christ. You're still going to receive another salvation. You're still going to receive something that you consider ultimate in your life, because the Bible is very, very clear that if you don't serve God, you're going to serve an idol. You're going to serve some God substitute in your life. And Jesus says this in Matthew 24:24, where he talks about, again, in the last days, the very days we're living, there will be false Christs and false prophets appear. Now, that could mean a wild-eyed lunatic with long hair leading masses of people onto a mountain to drink some funky Kool-Aid. It could mean that, but many times it doesn't necessarily mean that, but it means movements. It means ideologies. It means ideas that people run after that will lead them astray because they think it's going to save them. They think it's going to heal them. They think it's going to rectify the human condition, and they miss out. That's the tragedy of the human condition, is that you're either going to receive Jesus or you're going to receive some Jesus or salvation substitute. Again, what am I talking about? How about politics? Politics is all the rage in America. In a country that has largely jettisoned the Christian worldview from the public square, the only thing left to cause the nation to cohere and gather together is politics. And so the thinking is, hey, if we could just get the right politician in office in Washington, if we could just elect this politician or that politician, if we could just have a Christian America with the right leadership, okay, that will save us. False messiahs, something it's as a substitute for Jesus. I'm thinking of all the liberation movements in America, whether it's critical theory, the Black Lives Matter political movement, or all these other movements that are trying to liberate America and Americans from some form of social oppression. Okay, does injustice happen in America? Sure it does. But what people miss in so many of these secular and leftist movements are that they miss the fundamental injustice that occurs in the world, and that is this: not giving God his due. If we don't give God his due, we will not give other humans their due. That's why injustice happens. So they're trying to deal with the wicked fruit of human injustice, and they don't go deep enough to the actual root, which is rebellion towards God and people not giving God their due. But again, if you don't go after Jesus, if you don't receive Jesus as Lord, you're going to go after some ideology, some ism, some movement that promises liberation, promises peace, promises deliverance, pick your word. It's a false messiah that leads to a false gospel, which leads to a false salvation. But what John's gospel concludes with in verse 12 is the punchline of this whole message, and that is simply this: but to all who received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God. And so if you're watching this and you've never received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, okay, I encourage you to be open to receive him. Because if you don't receive him, the Bible is very clear that to not receive him, to reject Jesus, is to reject the author of life, and in eternity, you will be separated from God and his light and his life, and you will be basically in a world of darkness and pain. It's just, you know, the Bible calls it hell. It's brutal, okay? But we don't have to have that. We don't have to. In fact, that's what Jesus came. That's Christmas. That's the incarnation. That's the visitation that has come to reach out to every single person. And I want to encourage you to pray this prayer with me if you've never made Jesus Lord of your life. Can you do that? Lord Jesus, I come before you and I receive you. I receive what you have done for me on the cross. I receive your salvation. I repent. I turn away from my sins. And I receive what you've done for me, and I want to walk in and live in your kingdom. So from this day forward, I will receive you. I will follow you all of my days in Jesus' name. And the Bible says if you've done that, you are born again. You've been translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of God's dear Son, Jesus Christ. And you have eternal life right now. But the beauty of this is it will last forever, and you will find that you are a different person because you are made alive spiritually because his life has come in you. And so I encourage you, if you've done that, reach out to me at PastorEric@lmcc.church. I would love to hear from you and love to talk to you about your new life in Christ. And my prayer for every single one of you that are watching is that as we're talking about a visitation today, my prayer for all of you is that you will have a visitation from God this Christmas season. That what your need is, what your concern is, whether it's sickness, whether it's financial struggles, whether it's relational struggles, whether there's something going on in your life and family, my prayer for every single one of you this Christmas season is that you will have a visitation from God, and he will meet you in a special way. You are not alone. The Bible says he never leaves us. He will never forsake us. The Bible says very clearly that he is near to those that are brokenhearted. And so I pray and declare that God's presence will touch every single one of you that are watching in a special way this Christmas, Lord God. I pray this and I thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, church, it was great to be with you, and I call you blessed, and I say have a blessed Christmas with your family, and until next week, take care.